Hello everyone, thank you for being here today. I'm Ulrich Sidney, the president of the Association of Future African Neurosurgeons, and today we have a lecture from Professor Kazadi Kalangu. Before we start with Professor Kazadi Kalangu, we'll go around and have everyone present themselves. So when I call upon you, please unmute your mic and tell us where you are and what you're doing, what your profession is. So first up, Dr. Andrew Alalade.
Oh, thanks, Ulrich. Yeah, so Andrew Alalade here. I'm a Scobies and vascular neurosurgeon. I work in Preston in the UK. I'm not working today, and I heard Professor Kalangu was talking, so I definitely had to come and listen. So good.
Thank you so much. Yes, thank you, Dr. Andrew. Dr. Andrew is one of those mentors and advocates at the back who's been helping us from the get-go. Thank you so much for being here today. So Daniel Safari, please, can you present yourself?
Hello, everyone. I'm Daniel Safari Nkoranya from Democratic Republic of Congo. I'm actually the coordinator of Incision DRC and a research fellow from MAFAN. So I'm glad to be here today.
Well, nice to have you, Daniel. Thank you so much for being here today. David Ulrich Daly.
Hello everyone, I'm David Ulrich Daly, student in Russia. I'm first year medical student. I'm originate from Cameroon, and I am equally member of the communication department of AFAN. Thank you.
Well, thank you so much, David. Next up, Dr. Diomessi Kabulo.
Hello, everyone. My name is Kabulo from Democratic Republic of Congo. I'm newly qualified neurosurgeon from University of Zimbabwe under Professor Kalangu. Nice to meet you all.
Well, nice to have you, Dr. Kabulo. Well, when we talk about those who've been supporting us from the beginning, Dr. Kabulo is one of those seniors who's been here for as long as he can, as long as we started. And he's always been supporting us in the background too. Thank you so much, Dr. Kabulo. Next up, Genevieve Ndale.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Ndale Genevieve, fourth year medical student at the University of Boya in Cameroon. I'm also a member of communication and operation of AFAN. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Ndale. Next up will be Dr. Gomsi, Dr. Natalie Gomsi. Please present yourself.
Hello, everyone. Really nice to be here today to follow Professor Kalangu. I am Natalie Gomsi from Cameroon, and I'm a PGY2 in Ivory Coast, actually, and also the Secretary General of AFAN. Thank you to be here with you.
Well, thank you, Dr. Gomsi. We have Olaoluwa Ezekiel.
Good evening, everyone from Nigeria. Olaoluwa Ezekiel, Dada, second year medical student from University of Ibadan. Thank you.
Thank you so much for representing the University of Ibadan. And then next we have Dr. Stan Mashamba.
Hello, everyone. I'm Dr. Stan Mashamba, second year MMed neurosurgery at the University of Zimbabwe College of Health Sciences under Professor Kalangu.
Thank you for being here. Dr. Sylvia Shitsama.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Dr. Sylvia Shitsama, a consultant neurosurgeon from Kenya and a lecturer at one of our young medical schools at Kenya, Jomo Kenyatta University of Agriculture and Technology. It's a pleasure being here.
Thank you so much. Zolo Ivan, please present yourself.
Hello, everyone. I am Zolo Ivan. I am a medical student from the University of Buya in Cameroon. I am also the head of communication and operations at AFAN, also a research fellow at AFAN. And it's an honor and pleasure for us to receive Dr. Kalangu today. I mean, Professor Kalangu today. We are so so grateful. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Zolo. We have Stefan Gembo, Dr. Stefan Gembo.
Yes. Hi, everyone. Sorry for being late. My name is Gembo Stefan. I'm a general practitioner from Cameroon. I'm also the head of research department of IFAN. Professor Kalangu, thank you so much for taking time for us. Hello, everyone.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, Dr. Gembo. We still have a few people coming in. Dr. Aminata Sala, we can't go without having her present here. Dr. Sala, please can you unmute and present yourself?
Good afternoon. I'm Aminata Sala here. I'm a third year neurosurgical registrar training in Zimbabwe, University of Zimbabwe. I'm from the Gambia and resident in Namibia. And it's an honor to be present here for Prof. Lang's presentation.
Thank you, Dr. Aminata. So next up, we'll introduce our guest speaker today. Our guest speaker is Professor Kazadi Kalangu. Professor Kazadi doesn't need any presentation, but we have to try, and we'll try our best to do him justice, which is not easy in itself. To put it simply, Professor Kalangu is full professor and head of the Department of Neurosurgery at the University of Zimbabwe, College of Health Sciences, and he is a member of the Education Committee of the WFNS, which is the World Federation of Neurosurgical Societies. He is equally the former second vice president of the World Federation of Neurosurgical Societies and former president of the Association of Neurosurgical Societies of Africa. He's an honorary president of the CANS, which is the Continental African Association of Neurosurgical Societies. And Professor Kazadi Kalangu has been a mentor, a teacher, a father to a lot of African neurosurgeons. You may have met some of them, like Dr. Kabulo, who's here today as well. Equally, Dr. Ignatius Esene. And when you hear those names, you know the quality of work they've been producing in neurosurgery research practice, and that says a lot about the kind of mentor and teacher that they had. This is actually a testament of the legacy that Professor Kalangu has built ever since he returned from his training abroad to Africa. So today, Professor Kalangu is going to speak about the practice of neurosurgery in challenging conditions based on his experience as a teacher, as a neurosurgeon, as a scientist. We look forward to this presentation. Please go ahead and unmute your mic and share your screen, please. Thanks.
Thank you very much.
You see there, I'm showing you the map of Africa, and you can see Zimbabwe there. And then here, it is the map of Zimbabwe that has been sort of magnified. And you see Harare there on top, where most of neurosurgery is being done. But we have also a department of neurosurgery in the second city, which is called Bulawayo, which is also working. So this shows you already the distance patients have to travel to have, the neurosurgical treatment. Here's our medical school. Okay, you can still hear me, maybe?
Yes, we can hear you.
Perfect. Good. This is a medical school. Now I'm going to describe the type of challenges one can find when working in Africa. I'll talk about, first of all, the definition of developing country, which is it looks so obvious, but you'll see how complicated it is. I'll talk about my personal experience, not because I want to talk about myself, I want just to talk about something which I went through. It's a life experience rather than something I read from the book. And also, the challenge coming back to Africa, it is a challenge. One would say we're an African, so going back to Africa, it would be so obvious. Not at all. And not only you'll be not accepted as an African coming back, but also to be accepted as a neurosurgeon. Then there's the challenge of building a neurosurgical team and make people change their habits, because neurosurgery requires a special kind of habit. It's not like a general surgery. See, I'll talk to you more about that. Then we talk about equipment, we talk about the relationship with the authorities, the decision makers, how to do some lobbying. Then you talk about neurosurgical techniques. Do we have opportunities to do the latest technology, which you cannot afford, because when there are complications, you cannot actually look after correct them, or to have an adequate operation which was done maybe 10 years ago, but it's much safer and it's looking very well. But I'll talk to you about that as well. We'll talk about research. We'll talk about the influence of traditional medicine. Yes, traditional medicine exists in Africa. Unfortunately, we Africans, and of course the rest of the world, we tend to look down upon our traditional medicine. There are a lot of things which are good, but it's up to us to choose between all the things which are there. Some are not good, but we need to look into our traditional medicine as well. Then, of course, the continuous education. I know Indian people, you are so eager to learn that it's not a problem, but still, we'll talk about that. Then we'll talk about the training of young neurosurgeons, doctors and young neurosurgeons. Then we'll talk about how can we contribute to the world neurosurgery. And, of course, a very important point, a neurosurgeon has to be economically independent. How to be economically independent while in Africa? Now, the definition of developing country. Usually people say, countries which are not industrialized, then those countries are actually underdeveloped. Then we'll find another definition that will say, per capita income, if their per capita income is below a certain number, then you are underdeveloped. And the other definition is developing countries are those countries who are needing help, but usually this help is imposed. Even when you don't like it, people actually push you to get that help because of the NGOs. For them to survive, they have to show that they're helping. Developed countries, so they're saying, when you don't have access to water, then you are underdeveloped. Then others are saying infant mortality. I'm giving you all that to show that nobody knows at the end of the day what is a developing country. And when you see too many definitions, it means things are not very clear. Look here, somebody showed one day a map of the world from a satellite, and he will tell you, because those countries where it is dark, then they are underdeveloped. Okay. But when you see there are a lot of light, then those countries are developed. You know. Okay. Well, that's difficult, you know, to discuss. Now, however, there are few questions we have to ask ourselves as Africans or people from economically challenged countries. When patients have to travel long distances for treatment, that's something we need to think about. When pathologies are gross or sometimes incurable, that's another challenge, you know. Then when patients, although they have traveled long distances, but they cannot afford the treatment, that's really part of the problem. We are saying, well, that's something we need to work on. Now I'm giving you things which can make us either developed or not developed, because this development is according to ourselves, what we are doing. Now, sometimes you treat patients, but they go back and continue to maintain the habits which generate the disease. The other point is, sometimes you have countries with lack of basics. You know, there is a big hospital in Kinshasa called Mama Yemo, which is not far from the Congo River. The Congo River is huge. Okay, it's about, I think, 30,000 cubic meter of water. I'm wrong here, but a lot of cubic which are passing through there per second. Yet you go into the hospital, people are dying because they don't have normal saline. And you know normal saline. It's just a matter of having water and put some salt in it. Okay. You need, of course, to clear that water. And the technology is very, you know, basic. You see this child with a huge hydrocephalus. Fortunately, they arrested hydrocephalus, but still this child is not independent. That's a problem. Now, let me show you my personal history. They were training in 1985 in Liège, Belgium, and I've been in Europe for 14 years. My basic degree in medical and medicine was then in Padua University in Italy. Then I did my specialization here in Belgium. Then I went to Zimbabwe, that's in January 1987. It was a newly independent country, which has been independent from 1980. So this country was under apartheid regime. So the habits of separating black community, white community, Indian community, and so on were still there, even though the country was independent. For me, it was a new African country because originally I'm from DRC, Congo. You go to a country, for me, it was like it was Africa, but still a foreigner. So I was happy to be in Africa, but it was still a foreign country. It is an English-speaking country, and there is a different way of thinking. But not only that, people were questioning how I did my neurosurgery in French, because they thought neurosurgery should be taught in English. You know, how can you learn neurosurgery speaking French? Because French is a language for, you know, caviar, good wine, and good, you know, you talk about perfume and things like that, you know. So it's very, very interesting. Now, in Zimbabwe, I found that neurosurgery was actually being practiced since 1952 by Professor Levy. Okay, it was macrosurgery. As you can imagine, those days they didn't have microscopes. And the neurosurgery was about trauma, brain abscesses, central nervous system, TB, parasitosis. So, nobody was talking about brain tumors, cerebral hemorrhages, spinal cord tumors, pituitary tumors. They thought they were not, they were very rare in black population. The investigations, we had a skull X-ray, carotid angiogram, ventriculogram, and myelogram, which are very toxic products called, those days, Lapiodol, you know. I'm sure you don't even, you don't know that, you know. You should go to the museum to find those things. And above all, there was a pessimism. Neurosurgery meant death, okay, because complications were so very common. Now, you must know that when you bring a new technology, I go to Zimbabwe, the microsurgery with a microscope and so on and so forth. But when you bring a new technology, you will cause pain. You disturb people because you are going to move them from the comfort zone. You see, human being moves always towards pleasure, but towards pleasure in 30 to 40% of the time. But most of them, they run away from pain in 60 to 70% of the time. So if what you is perceived as pain, they will fight you because you are causing pain. Whether you are African or non-African, you will have problems even in your own country, you know, because of that. Okay. Now, Francophone training versus English training, you know, you have people fighting saying, well, I have the best training because I train in English-speaking country. Somebody will say, oh, I have the best training because I trained in French-speaking country. Rather than focusing on the training itself, the knowledge. So, the best thing in this situation, just do what they are already doing. Because you find that some of these general surgeons have been doing a bit of neurosurgery, and somehow they feel already neurosurgeons. But you do the same thing, but we do it better. With time, they will just give up and saying, well, I think he's the best, and then we leave him a god. And the rarity of some of the diseases, don't argue and saying, yes, they should be there. No, 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 no. Just gather those. When you have about six of them, you organize a small conference and you show that to everyone. Then they start to believe that, you know, that pathology exists also in the country. There is a human challenge. You know, the nurses we found in Africa are actually polyvalent. It means they're not specialized. They will bring you a nurse who has been working in a gynecology to neurosurgery. And you have to be very patient. You have to be there most of the time. You have to change the habits. And the best way to make people change their habits is to do it yourself. Okay. You have to know how to work in ICU, how to clear the tracheal tube suctioning, and in the ward, you have to show yourself, sisters, the nurses, how to move patients. Because when you tell them, if a patient who is in the bed, that you need to change his position every 2 hours, they will question that. Why? Why 2 hours? You know, they will think it should be 3 hours or 4 hours. You have to tell them why. If they don't do it, you can't do it yourself. When they see that you have done it twice, three times, they say, oh, they think they start to believe that, or see, or realize that they are becoming redundant. And the human being, you are causing now pain, they will come and do it for you. In theater, you see that the patients, the nurses, might know only 20% of what you are doing. Your surgery is not something you can improvise. So, what you do, you check the instruments yourself the day before. They start a checklist. And with the nurse, you practice the day before. You know that time one, you give me this. Time two, you give this. And each time you finish one step of the operation, you stop, talk to the nurse, prepare the instruments for the second step, and so on and so forth. When she does very well, praise the effort. That will help the nurse to improve quickly, and will help you, and they will come rather than getting, you know, cross and start now to throw the instruments and so on. No. Be very calm and focus on the 20% they know. And progressively, they will know 30%, 40%, and so on and so forth. In your training, you have to broaden your knowledge. You see, particularly in Europe, okay. Why? Because when you are working in Africa, sometimes you will need and you'll be required to do everything on your own. For example, you should know how to use transthoracic approach to access T-spine, thoracic spine. You need to do it about maxillofacial surgery, because when you have somebody with a head injury, and you need to know how to do that. You need to know how to do your tracheostomy. It's very important, because the ENT surgeon will tell you, oh, I'll come, and then after a week, he's no longer there. He's not there to come and help you. But you can do it yourself, and you do it yourself. Very important. And the equipment side, you start with available equipment and keep going. That's the most important thing. You keep going even with basic operations. Don't embark in very complicated operations. Avoid to do that, because if you don't have the appropriate equipment, don't do that. Do the simple things, so that progressively, then you get more instruments, then you start to do more complicated things. You can manufacture some of the equipment. I'll show you some of the equipment, the way we did it. And it's very important to know how to run the equipment, how to put the microscope, how to do this, how to do that. Don't rely on a technician, particularly, you know, working in Europe and America, you know, where everybody is there, you know, to help you. No, learn how to do it yourself. And when the machine is broken and the technician comes, you know, to repair it, come with discretion, watch the technician. Usually technicians, they think that doctors are stupid, you know, they don't understand it. And you watch, and you see the weakness of the equipment. Usually the fault is always the same, and it repeats. You will see that one day when it is broken, you open and see, oh, that's what it did. You do it yourself. You become like a, you know, a guru. And also adapt your surgical technique to the available resources. Don't try to do the latest thing with equipment which are not adequate. You fail, and you start to explain now a lot of things. People, they don't want explanations, they want results. Look, for example, here. Okay. On the right hand side, that's the cutlery we all know, you know, which you can buy from whatever. But this is what we made. We just bought it, and then we made our own. It works as well as this one. Very good. After all, these things, you know, when you put them to do hemostasis, after, what do you do? You give them to the nurse, and then she will throw them. Okay. Same thing for the cotton. By doing that, we couldn't stop an operation because we didn't have cotton, because you could make them. It's a very simple technology. Now, there is also a political challenge. We blame politicians and saying, you know, they didn't do this, they didn't do that, they don't understand us. First of all, you must have a clear idea of your needs. You must always have your list ready. Okay. And when you go and talk to the minister, express things we are talking to the layman, the layman. It's very important. Expressing the layman with the layman language. Even if the minister is a doctor, because he's a doctor, but he's not a neurosurgeon. And when you talk to the minister, this is the trick. If the minister is talking slowly, yes, I understand you, and I will look into it. Don't come and talk quickly. No. Talk exactly the way he's talking. Use his own vocabulary. The vocabulary is understanding. And always keep your smile and go to the point. Of course, you'll be thrown away. But when they kick you out from the door, come back to the window. Up to 6 times. Keep always smiling. Show determination. Improve your argumentation, the way you talk, argument. Okay. And after 6-7 times, the minister will say, oh, that man, okay, please, give him what you want, because, you know, this world is people who are actually lobbying a lot. Those people, they get what they want. And we have to be people who are lobbying all the time. That's how I got my first scan in Zimbabwe. That's how I got, you know, the instruments in Zimbabwe, is by lobbying and going regularly to see the minister. By the way, when you talk to the minister, you must talk about the improvement in terms of economy. What I did to the minister in Zimbabwe, I just showed the amount of money we're spending with patients who were going to South Africa to be treated there. It was a huge amount of money. And also I said, you know, His Excellency, if you have a problem, of course, I'm touching the wood. I don't want things to happen. But we have to do this. We can immediately. Because the transfer can be actually, it will be delayed by the time you get there. We need to do a CT scan and do things here, at least the urgent things. So when you start to talk about that language, you see that start to convince now politicians. Now, from a research point of view, it is always possible. If somebody tells you, we are doing research because I don't have enough money, and all, no. That's not acceptable. Even without money, you can do a lot of research. You know, even in Europe, I saw the lab Italians. They don't have, they don't have a lot of money allocated for research. But if you see in the world in papers, they are in Europe the most prolific in terms of writing papers and the producing papers. So you can write, your paper, starting by solving your local problems. Okay. You know, I'll show you a few cases. And the world might acknowledge the work. Why not? Why? Because you have published it. If somebody goes to Canada, for example, and they see that this patient has got this problem, and they will look into the literature and say, oh, that one is a specialist, and they will call you to tell them what to do. Look for epidemiology. There are a lot of epidemiology. We haven't done in Africa. We don't even know what we have. If we don't talk about it, other people will talk about it. So we need to talk about ourselves. We have to be bold and write paper. Of course, the paper can be rejected one. You rewrite it, and you rewrite it after 3-4 times, and possibly team up with some people who have got experience, grown enough people, and they will help you, and eventually the paper will be published. Look here, for example. I'm showing you here a picture of bilharzia of the spinal cord. It's an entity which is not very, very, very known, see. And at the beginning, I actually did an operation. You see here, the granulations here, which are the bilharzia, and here, the histology, bilharzia. Now, we learned the clinical signs, how to find them. Then we didn't have to operate those patients. We just gave them medical treatment, and they did very well. Look here, for example, it's about the operation on the intramedullary tumor. Okay. Now, this is one of the difficult operation in neurosurgery. Okay. So, in those days, if you didn't have the Cavitron or ultrasonic aspirator, people said you don't touch this kind of patients. And we couldn't do it, of course, in Africa. Then one day, but the story is a bit long, I cut it short. We invented our technique where first step, we'll do a bielotomy. and then close the wound and come 2 weeks later. So when you come 2 weeks later, what's happening? You see that the tumor has actually extruded outside, you see, and becomes so easy to remove with the basic microsurgical technique. And you see here the tumor on the right side, the tumor has been removed. Okay, here, you see the tumor here has been removed. Okay, and guess what? I had exactly the same results as people who had actually atrophic aspirated. And it was published in Surgical Neurology in 1996. I got later on a lot of letters from people from developed countries. They say, oh, thank you so much. We are using your technique as well, because even with fuser and ultrasound aspirator, sometimes you cannot remove everything. So what we do now, we remove what we can, we wait 2 weeks, and we come back later, and we manage to remove it, you see. So this is a technique which was developed in third world country, okay, and yet used in first world countries. Look here. I showed you a child with a huge hydrocephalus. Now, those children, in fact, there were so many of them, there are still many of them, we couldn't operate them because the shunts were so expensive, you know. A shunt costing $200. When actually $200 is the maybe 5 months salary of the family, or even 3 months, or even 1 month salary. Who is going to spend that, you know? So we said, by the way, the first neurosurgeon who made the shunt, made it in his garage, we should be able to do that. So we managed now to make this shunt, which is called Arare shunt, Arare valve, which worked very well. It was taken in the laboratory in France, Paris, and the neurosurgeons there, when they did the experiment, they showed that it performed as well as the most sophisticated shunt. So it was very good. And we could make our shunts ourselves. And we were actually, at the time, making even workshops to teach neurosurgeons how to make your own shunt. Now, look our contribution to the world. We did this research, you know, together with Ignatius in Sene and others, and to show that 40% of the studies published on the top neurosurgical journals, you know, and we actually misclassified. That was, you know, something interesting. And I'm in the editorial board of so many, editorial board of many journals, and now, regularly, they sent their papers and saying, what do you think about that? Now, that's basically coming to us, and they want to know the opinion, or our opinion. I need to say it to myself, you see. And the other paper we wrote, you know that one of the problems when you do a VP shunt is actually the infection rate. Now, the infection rate can be very, very high. So we managed, basically, to reduce the infection rate by just changing the way we are operating. We did also another paper, which was very successful, and just by observing cavernous sinus thrombosis. I know it's very rare in Europe, but we managed to do that and save patients. How we'll do that. This is a typical child with cavernous sinus thrombosis. You know, the mortality rate before was almost 90%, you know. It came down to 2% just by changing the way we treated those patients. This is a CT scan. We can do, you know, this cavernous sinus thrombosis. Okay. And we did that by understanding how the venous system was working. Okay. So I don't want to go into details too much because it will go beyond our presentation. And we also wrote some books. These books, Approaches to Spinal Surgery, it is bilingual, and also this Essential Practice of Neurosurgery, which was nominated by the World Federation as the basic book for young neurosurgeons. Okay, the training. With local resources, you can do a lot. Then you can use the regional resources, then the continental, and then the world at large. You can see the number of doctors we trained from, of course, I mean Zimbabwe, but also from different countries, Namibia, and there is here Gambia. So we are able to train quite a number of countries. Now, because I love to teach and go everywhere, so, and I was the secretary of the Pan-African Association of Neurological Societies, I had to travel a lot. You see in blue there, the number of countries I visited in Africa. So it gave me a lot of insight, you know, to know what were the problems in Africa. Some pictures about courses we organized. We are in Senegal here, still in Senegal with the dean. And here we are in Nigeria, which actually you know Yoko Kato and professor. Continuing education. Sometimes we say, I don't have money to do my continuing education. Each time you earn a bit of money, put 10% on the side for your income for further education. Nowadays, before we used to buy books. Now you can get actually electronic versions. I know that youngsters after exchanging books, it has become very, very easy, you know, to do that because of this global solidarity. We didn't even have to subscribe to magazines because you can actually, I know youngsters, they've got tricks which they are also giving to me so that I can have access to those tricks as well, you know, to get them. And it's good to visit colleagues. When you go to visit colleagues, go to visit them, go in theater and learn at once. Even now, when I go, I like to go in theaters and see what other people are doing. I got involved into the committees. Here you see, I was invited. There was a symposium about pituitary tumors. You see here, Professor Oyesiko. You see all those people are giants in the. Why did they invite me? Because they saw that I could do the same operations with minimal resources and getting the same results. So I could talk in the forum of giants, you know. And I got congratulated by Professor Yazarfin, and it was very interesting. All that to show you that it's not where you come from, it's the quality of work, the work you are doing. Eventually, it will be noticed by people who are up there. Now, traditional medicine, it's well established in Zimbabwe and in Africa in general. Okay, you know, in Africa, they believe that, you know, the cause of the disease is about disharmony of vital powers and so on. So there are a lot of philosophy behind that. And they have their own philosophy of life and death. But you know what? The traditional healers, they are good psychologists. They are caring. They are skilled psychotherapists. You see, a young doctor, you know, you get somebody who is much older than you can be, who can be your father or even your grandfather. And when they come here, you are calling them, oh, sir, come here. It's like orders. You minimize them. When they go to the traditional healer, they're actually called and greeted with a lot of respect so that they keep their own sort of position in the society, which we've lost with our modern medicine. And remember, they use widely plants and herbs. You know, it's very interesting that in Zimbabwe, you can see herbs people are using when they have a cough, when they have a fever, when they got this, and it works very well. And they use tattoo. I did a study on the tattoos, and 75% of people who have got backache, they go first to consult a traditional healer because they think somebody is trying now to stop them to reproduce themselves. So, and 60% have tattoo, but for him, it's quite interesting because if the tattoo, I saw them even so in priests, they also saw tattoos. It means they had gone to see the Nanga, and they have, of course, Nanga marks. You see here, for example, you see the Nanga marks here, you see there, in a patient who is having a lumbosciatica, and here, and down there, you see, okay. Now, guess what? We did the MRI, the Nanga was very right, you see. You see where the disc is, you know, compressing an S1 root, you see. So, you see here somebody with so many Nanga marks, and according to the age of the Nanga marks, you could determine that this is recent, that's very old. And the number of Nanga marks will tell you the how the pain, where the pain, the pain, where the, how do you call it, patient who had TB spine with these abscesses, paravertebral abscesses, you know. So those people are not really completely stupid. There are people who know things. They never went to school, but they have experience. So we shouldn't ignore them. I'm not saying we're going to do everything they are doing, but we shouldn't ignore them. Now, let's talk about the financial independence. When you are a doctor, people always think, ah, you are a doctor, you know, the doctor, they like money, you know, or the doctor, they are charging too much, you know. But when they say they like money, okay, I always tell patients, oh, okay, if you say we like money, okay, it means you don't like money. So if you don't like money, give it to me. Okay. And you see people now, they start to hesitate. It's very important to tell people that in business terms, your product is a treatment to patients, okay? You are treating patients not for free. They have to pay. And those who cannot pay, you have to decide yourself whether to treat them free or not, you know, because it's a work. And something which will disappoint you, you will never be a millionaire by doing neurosurgery. But it is actually a leverage. Create your saving plan for life. Not tomorrow, starting today, okay? And educate yourself in finances. You know, when you go to bank and talk to the banker, they will use a lot of special vocabulary and things like that, you know. If you can understand the cranial nerves, you can understand all the things, you know, in the neurology and the neurosurgery, you can also understand finances. So it's just get the books, read them, and you'll be most independent, and you know what to do. You can invest in property. The money you earn, you can actually invest in properties. Avoid, please, businesses where you don't know what is going on. Trust your intuition, you know. You can say, oh, I'm going to buy gold and sell. Well, are you able to recognize between the true gold and the fake gold? So go into business you understand very well, you master very well. Okay, you cannot do charity if you are poor. To be rich is not a sin, because poverty brings misery. Okay, if you see a priest or coming to talk to you about poverty, kick him away, you know, send him back. You know, you say, I'm not interested, because it's only when you are rich that you can actually change your own environment. And also, you have to secure yourself your retirement, because if I told you what I would be getting when I retire, it's really peanuts. Because in our countries, not only in our countries in Africa, even in Europe, the people who retire, they get really peanuts. Okay, we don't want to finish like that. I showed you a few cases. You know, we operated. Look here, the child soon after the operation, this is a few months later, you see here occipital encephalocele, you see a posterior fossa tumor, you see here cysticercosis of the spine, okay, treated medically, and you can see here also cysticercosis in the brain, okay, and one would think, oh, this is, you know, stroke, and no, it's not an stroke, it's not an infarct. You see that it's behaving as a spacer-to-bind lesion. This is why you see the ventricle has collapsed, you know. And this patient was also treated. And you see other patients with cysticercosis. So just showing you a number of things we've done. Of course, the typical abscess. Okay. You see myelomeningocele. We see also aneurysm. Okay. We see also aneurysms. And tumors of the brain, these are meningioma, which was protruding. This man came to see me, not because actually he was having headaches or so, but he wanted to get married. So he wanted to make sure that this thing, you know, is removed. He thought it was maybe or whatever. So just showing you, I mean, instruments we have now. This is a pediatric ward. You see here, we are in theater. Here I'm preparing to do a digital tumor ward round. And here, I write your neuropolitics in there. It's because I was actually in the committee, for nominating a committee. So that's where you learn the neuropolitics. So neurosurgery is not only being a good neurosurgeon, it's also politics in neurosurgery. Well, we could have a whole sort of presentation on that. So in conclusion, developing countries is actually a state of mind, is a way of thinking, which you keep going by yourself, or is sustained by people outside. You know, you see, European countries and developed countries, they want Africa to be always seen as a developing country, because when you're developing, so somebody has to develop you. Okay. Thinking developing country is means remaining developing all the time. It means stagnation. Never think that you're developing. Changing the way of thinking means progress towards your own development. And your own development, the way actually you fix it, is actually your first world. Be modern, but not just to be modern, but for efficiency with appropriate equipment. Now, working in developed countries is to be polyvalent. You have to be like a commando in the army. You need to, with minimal resources, you can do a lot of things. With maximum resources, you can still do things. Very important. You have the mentality of what? Of I am enough. Where I am, with what I have, I'm enough, I can do things. I'm not saying you should stop there. Then you start to improve progressively. I start by thinking, I am enough. I'm enough, I'm capable of doing this. Okay. Working in developed countries can be exciting, but you must know the rules of the game to be in charge, and you have to be inventive as well. At the end of the day, if you believe you can, you're right. But if you believe you cannot, you're also right. So the choice is yours. So this is a bit beauties of Zimbabwe. Thank you very much.
Wow. Thank you so much, Professor, for this brilliant presentation. Thanks. So the first things first, if you have questions, please send them in the chat and we can ask the professor those questions. I will go first, if you don't mind, Professor.
No problem.
My question is a bit about the when you said we should think about developing solutions locally, and one of the key solutions you developed is the Harare Shunt. Can you take us through that process, the process through which you came up with the Harare Shunt in itself?
Okay. You know, when you observe the basic shunt, it's about a tube which is going to the ventricle, and another tube which is going to the abdomen. Now, the problem now is about the shunt itself. Now, you see, usually there is a shunt between the ventricular catheter and the abdominal catheter. You put a shunt in between. You put a valve. Now, what we did is to do some openings on the bottom of that tube, which is up to, of course, the end of the tube is closed with, how do you call it, liquid silicone. And the tube itself is in silicone, medical grade. And the size of the opening will determine whether the shunt will be high pressure shunt, normal shunt, or lower pressure shunt. Okay. So it means those cutting on the back, on the bottom of the catheter, will open when the column of CSF goes beyond 10 to 11 centimeters in the normal sort of size of the shunt. That's how we did it, and it worked very well. Now, people will say, oh, what about the siphoning? So we found the trick. Is that when you put a shunt, particularly in children with a huge head, they have the tendency to have, these subdural, what do with Shan. That's why you have this Shan, what you call programmable Shan. So you don't need the programmable Shan. What we do is, when we do that operation, we keep the child flat for 48 hours. Then we start now to lift up the head progressively by 30 degrees first day, and then 50 degrees, and progressively. By doing that, we avoid actually the problem of for the patient developing now a subdural hematoma. And this technique has been used even by other colleagues who are using the most sophisticated shunts. They also start now to lift up patients progressively and to avoid that complication.
Well, thank you so much. Thank you so much. And then the next question will be about building a network, a professional network. What is your advice for future neurosurgeons and current neurosurgeons about building that network both on the continent and outside the continent?
Yes, it's very important. Even right now, I have a lot of friends in the world. So if I have a complicated case, even though I might know the solution, I will send the case to all my friends and saying, what do you think? It doesn't mean that you get actually the correct answer or the answer you want. You might get actually different answers. Okay, let me tell you about a case. I saw a patient, he had a vascular abnormality inside the spinal cord and didn't have really major clinical signs. Later on, we found it looked like abnormal, anyway, which were confirmed later on. There's also cervical spine between C4 and C5. So, he was just having a bit of pins and needles on one of the hands. Otherwise, he was working without any problem, no neurological problem. But you know the natural history of cavernoma is that it can bleed. And when it bleeds, patient can come completely paralyzed. So, you know, when you are paralyzed, you are paralyzed. Okay. So I sent that to many colleagues, to some from the United States and some, but the reaction was fantastic. Many of them, majority, they say, oh, leave it alone and wait until if it bleeds, then you go in, you know, because of course everybody was scared about what's gonna happen if you do it and then patient has complication. Then I spoke to another colleague who was part of the team who trained in neurosurgery, Professor Brocci, who is a very specialist, specialized in intramedullary tumors. He said, oh, this is a cavernoma. Okay, you can go in. You do it gently and try to coagulate the cavernoma. By coagulating, it will shrink and then actually got away, and you can see down the plane of cleavage between the cavernoma and the spinal cord. Okay. The second thing you have to do is that your assistant might put regularly a lot of fluid so that you cool down that area so that you don't burn the spinal cord. So I did that, and a patient came out, you know, moving without any problem, and so on. And I sent that case, you know, to everyone. They were very, very, you know, impressed, very shocked also. And you can see Americans didn't want, why? Because of the liability and because of the problems, you know, they are having in Latin America, you know, malpractice and so on. And the others were, so it was more a fear. But eventually I got somebody not to tell. So we need to have a network of people where you have a problem. You send us your problem and get opinions. And then you sit down and adapt all the solutions according to your environment. So it's very important to have that network, because the world now is very small. Mm-hmm. In fact, the coronavirus, the positive part of the coronavirus, COVID-19, is to show us that you can communicate. Look, for example, you are in America, there's somebody in UK, somebody else is in Zimbabwe, somebody else in the DRC, I'm here in Belgium. You see, it's like as we were talking, you know, from the village across the road, you see.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you so much. So you are an educator and the head of the neurosurgery department in Zimbabwe, and we have a few aspiring neurosurgeons here. People would like to go into training, and they've heard a lot about the training program from Dr. Kabulo, Dr. Aminata Sala. So what can you tell those young folks about your center and the training experience they can expect if they were to come to Zimbabwe?
Absolutely. We are, you know, each time a young, you know, a young man or a young lady wants, you know, to do neurosurgery, I'm very excited, you know, to get them and so on. What they have to do is just, you know, to apply. It's very easy. They can get, I mean, I will send you my email address. Or they can connect with Dr. Gabulo or Dr. Minata. And then we'll give them all the requirements, and it's pretty very, very simple, because what's happening, we have every year about 3 or 4 positions, but we make sure that when you have 4 positions, there is always 1 or 2 positions for people coming outside Zimbabwe, because our center is recognized by the World Federation of Neurological Societies as a training center, international center. So we are obliged then to take obliged, but we are happy actually to have also international students. So there is always at least 1 or 2 positions for international students, and we are very glad to get them. Now, as you know, neurosurgery is very demanding. People think it is difficult. It's not difficult, but you have to put the number of hours which are needed to be excellent. This is not only neurosurgery everywhere. When you see, for example, I don't know if you know the soccer player here, Ronaldinho.
Yes.
Fantastic.
Yes.
Even Ronaldo was mm-hmm. fantastic. Now, when you see them, you say, oh, you know, oh, they are very good, you know, they are gifted and so on. But nobody knows the number of hours they have spent, they're spending to do, you know, to practice. That's very important. So I believe in the capacity. In fact, between somebody who is brilliant, who did everything, you know, in medical school and had AIDS everywhere, let's put it that way, okay? And the other one did B, but who is consistent and working hard and want to do things and so on. So I prefer the one with the B, because that one will go very far. The A one will rely on simple things. The moment they get difficulties, they will just stop, okay? So this is not, because I can't generalize that. I'm not saying I'm not going to take somebody else's get AIDS, of course, you know. But if you have AIDS, and at the same time you are motivated, so it's very important that motivation. I like that.
Mm-hmm.
The second quality I like builders. It's somebody, whether you send him or her to a place where there is nothing, they create something, you see.
Mm-hmm.
They are not losers, they are builders, you mm-hmm. see. Now, those people were expecting to find everything ready and, you know, they can just come and sit down and start to do. That's not really my my people. I prefer. I like people who are builders, you know, who have got character,
mm.
who can do things. Yeah.
Yes, thank you so much. A question from Dr. Gomsi Natalie about working with folks who are not in medicine to develop solutions. She gave the example of biomedical engineers, for example. In your experience, how often have you had to work maybe with engineers or other folks who are not in medicine to develop a solution?
Absolutely. And in fact, we have to continue to develop that. Though the way the universities are structured, we find that people are separated. One is doing this, one is doing that, you know, it's very difficult. And the other thing also is that you find people who don't believe in creating things from Africa. Let me give you a simple example. When I was studying in Liège and we started to do these pituitary tumors, you know, now to find out which kind of hormones these pituitary tumors were producing, we had to create some antibodies. And the way we're doing them in rabbits. And we created, and of course, it doesn't that and eventually the industry took it over and then made, I mean, some kits and so on and so forth. So we got to, I got to Zimbabwe and then I told them, you know what, we don't have to send, you know, our samples to South Africa. Let's create our own samples. What we need just to get one tumor which is producing, I don't know, prolactin, for example, and inject into a rabbit, and after that we do, I mean, simple things which are done, even 1940-something, you know. I can tell you, nobody would buy that idea. Ah, come on, this thing has done already in England, you know, in Birmingham, or in Paris, you know. I said, well, why don't you create our own Paris and Birmingham here? I couldn't convince anybody to do that, you know.
Mm.
And it was very difficult to do that. So that's why I'm saying we need to get youngsters. I'm saying let's sit down and let's come with the solutions. So it's very important when you have an idea to get people who are thinking like you and involve them, whether they are in the Department of Chemistry or Department of Engineering, the Department, you need, but you need to push, you need to motivate them, you know. It cannot be always easy. But sometimes you have to go somewhere else. If in your environment, let's say in Zimbabwe, I cannot find anybody, I'll go somewhere else, you know. And I can get somebody from, I don't know, Cameroon, Gambia, and then we do, because the world, you know, is open. It's an open market, you know.
Mm-hmm.
If you know people from Zimbabwe start to complain, then we say, well, you know, I tried to approach you, you know, and you didn't like, you know, to work in this project. So it's very important, you know, when you have an idea, do it with somebody who will have to do it.
Mm. Yeah. Okay. Thank you so much. And this is a question from Ivan Zolo about medical students and advice, especially medical students who do not have access to neurosurgery instructors or mentors. What would be your advice to a young African neurosurgeon, aspiring African neurosurgeon who doesn't have access to mentors locally? How can they go about it to increase their interest?
No problem. You know, we can use, I like the our African habits, you know.
Mm.
If you don't have an uncle, you nominate an uncle. So if you don't have a mentor, you nominate a mentor. So they can write to me, they can write to other colleagues also from Africa and so on, you know, and just telling me or others what are the problems, and we can discuss together. And I will tell them, you know, I went through this, I went through that. Just giving you an example, you know, your own country, Cameroon. When Esene went there, it wasn't that easy. I told him, you know what? This, I went through this, I went through that and that and that. Just do this, just do that and that. So he is progressively, you know, doing things and is very happy and so on and so forth. So I'm open to give my experience and help youngsters, you know. So remember that you do it the African way. If you don't have a grandfather, nominate the grandfather. If you don't have an uncle, nominate your uncle.
Wow, that is amazing. Thank you so much, Professor. I think you covered everything about practicing in a low resource setting. We have questions that keep coming on, and I'm sure what we can do, we'll share the professor's email address so that you can,
yes,
you can all write to him the questions that you have.
Yes.
Thank you so much for coming today, for making the time. I mean, having someone of your caliber with us today means a lot.
You will have the same caliber. The caliber comes with the age, you know. It's like the wine, you know. The more you keep it, and you know, eventually you get old and you become good.
Wow. Well, thanks.